So I'm happy to be here and to share with all the audience an experience that is born in Italy, but I think it could be useful to discuss with a broader audience because it can help to understand something more about, it may help at least to understand something more about oral sources. You know, we are speaking of these kind of objects, or analog cassettes, open reels, something which appears to be very fragile and very difficult to handle. Just to have an idea, I prepared some key points of for the discussion because I feel that maybe not all the people here are familiar with oral sources. First of all, we are dealing with something which is very fragile. It is often stored in analog carriers. It is difficult to handle because oral sources need very special preserving condition in order to be readable and to be accessible. If you have only analog tapes, you have to find a way to digitize them. Especially, I'm talking about oral archives of the past, obviously, not about oral archives collected nowadays with digital device. So first of all, they are very fragile. They are often perceived by the researcher themselves as something private, in the sense that maybe people did interviews, transcribed them, and then put apart the original tapes because it's not considered as relevant as the written interview, as the written correspondence of the oral sources. It is not unfrequent also that once the transcription and the book and the article were published, the analog carrier were recorded again, and the very first interview was cancelled. We have a lot of example in the history of oral, in the history of oral history, in the history of dialectology and the sociolinguistics of case like that, in which the original tape was lost or was cancelled because people take care of the written version of the interview. Like, for instance, this kind of documents, which can be considered as oral sources as well, but they are not on the same level as the original carriers in which they were documented. The second point is that oral sources are at the crossroads of different fields of knowledge that are used in the domain of oral history, but also in the domain of sociology and of psychology, and also in the domain of linguistics and sociolinguistics, and also dialectology. So there are different vocabularies, different labels to used by different researchers, and there are several projects, at least in Italy, but I think in several parts of the world, and several initiatives and several repositories that are not connected to each other. So it's difficult to find a common point and common place in which all the oral archives, for instance, are collected or are put into relationship. As a consequence of the second point is that we found an absence of shared guidelines. Also, because when you think about archives, you think about written archives, you think about paper. You are not used to think about oral archives in a sense that you can have shared guidelines for describing them, for accessing them, and for disseminating them. So this was another aspect that could be taken into account and which has relevant aspect also on the legal face of the thing. The last thing is that oral archives are used by rather different types of users. Oral archives are used in the academia, but are also used in the museum, for instance, in the eco-museums, are used by artists, they are also used by people loving traditional music and traditional history of the place. So you have to think that maybe you have to prepare something which can be accessible by different type of users. And that's another kind of problem which can be taken into account when we are dealing with such artifacts. So this was our starting point. In Italy, the debate about archiving, describing, reusing oral sources was formalized, let's say, around the 80s. And several oral historians discuss about such sources. But only in the last years, we found a way to discuss together. I mean, between oral historians, among oral historians and linguists. And we have a seminal point in the ICE Congress, the Congress of the Italian Association of Speech Sciences, in Arezzo, where I'm working, in 2019. During that Congress, also Francisca de Jong was present as keynote speaker. So it was a moment in which also Clarine EU was really known and participated by the Italian communities of speech scientists, which were not so aware of the potential of this infrastructure. So it was a relevant moment, and we had a round table discussing about oral archives with different stakeholders. I mean, not only scholars, but also people from the national institutions of ministry, for instance, of Italian cultural ministry, and people working in libraries and in museums. And at that point, we decided that it was the moment to prepare something which was shared by a huge community, different communities of users in Italy. And we start working on a vademecum, some guidelines, a sort of guidelines for the use, for the description, the use and the reuse of oral archives. And we start working. We had a very first meeting in the spring of the same year. Then we had several other meetings. Then COVID arrived, so we start doing only online meeting. But just to have an idea, of all the people involved, just look at the list here in that slide. There were people from university, people from the National Institution Discoteca di Stato, which now has another name, but it is known as Discoteca di Stato in Italy. Private foundations, superintendenze, which are a sort of regional arm of the state in several parts of Italy, and obviously Monica Monachini from Clarinit, and several people coming from different association, disciplinary association, oral historians, archivists, speech scientists, and so on. We divided the work into three different areas. First of all, we prepared a table on the on the conservation of oral archives, another table on the description of oral archives, and the last group was devoted to the use and reuse of oral archives. All these people that you can find here worked together and tried to prepare and try to write together also. I have to say that in many cases, it was the very first time in the history of Italian literature, let's say, that people, that so different people from so different institutions start to, first of all, find a common vocabulary and start to work together to prepare something which was, which could be useful for next generation of users of oral sources. And also the age of the people is relevant to underline, because we have PhD students or postdoc students, and also people at the very end, and scholars at the very end of their career, working together and try to do something for the future. We had a moment in which we presented the different texts that we produced in a public event. It was it is in Italian, because the public was intended for was obviously Italian. It was for the World Day for Audiovisual Heritage, and it was a very crowded conference in which we presented what we did, and also politicians were present at that time, because we intended to speak also to stakeholders, not only to scholars, but also to stakeholders, in order to ask them who will care about the oral archives of the past. And you can see the different documents we produced, and we decide to keep that documents open for a public review. But before describing the public review, I would like to describe the structure of the Vade Vecum, just to have an idea of the work that we did. The Vade Vecum is divided into three different parts. The first one deals with production and description of oral sources. The second part with the conservation of oral sources, how to preserve oral sources from the analog version to the digitized version, and how to store them in a better way. The third part is devoted to the use and reuse and dissemination of oral sources. In addition, we prepare some additional documents which were useful for people dealing with oral archives, for instance, the informed consent form, according to the not only to the GDPR but also to the Italian law, a list of places in which you can go and digitize your oral sources, a list of places in which you can store your oral sources in case you are not able to store and you are afraid that you will not do it in for the future. Some acts some examples of act of donation, of testamentary legacy and deposit agreement, in order to make people aware of all the legal issues involved on the dissemination phase, or in case you have an oral archives that you want to give to someone else and you want to give to a public institution for public access, for instance, and then a list of references and a list of good examples of reuse of oral archives of the past. So this was the structure that we built all together, and all the documents were accessible via the web, also via the website of Clarinet, via the website of my Association of Speech Technologies, and via the Association of Oral Historians, and so on. We had some months in which people could access the text and propose changes, propose different point of views, and we had a rather good answers from the public. We also prepared a questionnaire in order to verify whether our work was good enough, whether it could be done better, whether we could do something in a different way, and so on. So we had several reviews, also very, very detailed and with very useful observations. And the people who answered to the public review were scholars. Also PhD students and archivists, librarians, documentalists. We had also a rather good degree of satisfaction because on a Likert scale from 1 to 4, we had more than 3. So we are very satisfied for this moment in which we had an answer from the public, from a different types of public. We had several events in Italy in order to disseminate our work, especially in public conferences and also in PhD program conferences in order to share this kind of knowledge. And now what we are doing, we are preparing the final version of the Vademecum, and we think that it will be ready for the summer of this year, and we will have a public presentation like the previous year, exactly the same day in the World Day for Audiovisual Heritage. We hope in presence, at least this is. Could be in our mind. We hope to have not an online presentation, but a true presentation of the final version of the Vademecum. Several scholars and postdoc students asked for a short version because the text we produce is rather huge. I have to say it is about 100 pages of text. So people asked for a short version of the text, and we are also, when we will have the final version, we will also prepare an English version of the text in order to have this experience more widespread also outside Italy. And we are also preparing several tutorial and dissemination activities among students and especially PhD students who are collecting oral sources and who are not so aware of all the problems that are involved in this kind of documentation. So this is what we did in the last year, I have to say. And I would like to stress that this kind of experience cannot be done alone. It is really an outcome of something which is very participated and which is done with by different actors. Monica Monachini was the key points to the Clarin EU, and she helped us with all the Clarin issue involved in this kind of work. But at the same time, other people helped us in connected with different levels of working in oral archives. So I have to thank all the people involved. I have to thank Francesca, who let me, who gave me the possibility to describe this experience, which was for me a very exciting and inspiring experience, because I think you in this case you are doing something for others, for the new generation of researchers, and that's the difference from writing a paper on your own. So thank you.